Tuberculosis in humans is caused by the bacterium Mycobacterium tuberculosis. It is a non-motile obligate anaerobe, which means that they will die in the presence of oxygen. They are rod-shaped, as shown in the image on this slide, also known as bacilli, and they are about 2 to 4 micrometers in length. The cell wall of this particular bacterium is different in that it is made up of acidic acids called mycolic acids. This helps the bacteria by making it resistant to drying and use of chemicals. These mycolic acids is where the bacterium gets its name. Mycobacterium can be found in airborne particles that are created when a person who is already infected with pulmonary or laryngeal TB cough, sneeze, or shout. If these airborne droplets are inhaled by another person, the bacteria journeys through the nasal passages, upper respiratory tract, and bronchioles to reach the alveoli of the lungs. It is known that people who are immunocompromised are more likely to develop TB, as well as those who have been diagnosed with cancer. People who smoke are also at risk because smoking impairs the pulmonary system, which would normally be able to fight off the pathogen. TB is also the leading cause of death among people living with HIV, and thousands of people die yearly from AIDS-related tuberculosis. Here on this slide, I have a map of TB incidences all around the world, with the darker green areas showing a higher average of TB infections. A lot of these areas suffer poor sanitation, which is why there seem to be more cases there. In someone who has a healthy immune system, the body will be able to destroy the pathogen. This is the reason why many people will not get sick if they inhale this bacterium. Infection with the pathogen triggers cell-mediated immunity, which is shown in the image on this slide, where a macrophage or white blood cell attempts to phagocytose the bacterium. In humoral immunity, T cells are immune cells that play an important role against TB. T cells recognize antigens or peptides present on the bacterium, which will then proliferate and migrate to the lungs so that the antibodies can be made against the bacteria. Unfortunately, the bacteria have certain mechanisms that allow them to survive in the lungs for long periods of time. When the bacteria phagocytose, it is able to prevent the programmed cell death of the macrophage so that it can hide out in the lungs. Another virulence factor that the bacteria has is called T-reg cells that greatly suppresses T-cell immunity so that they can't do their job effectively. If someone has been infected with TB and does not get sick, this is considered latent infection. Pathogen stays in the body and can be activated years later if the immune system suddenly becomes weakened. At this stage, the bacteria cannot be spread to others. If the immune system can't stop the bacteria from growing, the person infected will become sick and will start showing symptoms. As shown here, the symptoms include an increase in body temperature or fever, chills, weight loss, chest pain, weakness or fatigue, hemoptysis, which is the coughing up of blood or sputum, no appetite, persistent cough that lasts 3 weeks or longer, and irritability. If not treated, this can lead to death. To test for the presence of TB in the patient, doctors can perform the following test. First one is the skin test, also called the mantle tuberculin skin test. This is done by injecting a small amount of tuberculin fluid into the skin. If swelling or raised growth is seen after 48 to 72 hours of the infection, this will be considered a positive test. Posterior anterior chest radiograph is another test that is used to detect abnormalities in the chest. This can be anything from lesions, which can differ in shape and size. Microbiologists can also perform a sputum smear, which is observed under the microscope, to see if there is presence of acid-fast bacilli. A positive test does not necessarily mean that the patient is infected with TB. You can see a bacilli smear in the middle of the slide. To confirm the presence of TB, a culture is done on a sputum sample to see if there is growth. Shown on the image on the top right are colonies of Mycobacterium tuberculosis on an agar plate. Isocyanate, rifampin, ethambutol, and pyrazinamide are all antibiotics that have been found to be effective against TB. Normally, people should begin to take antibiotics when they are in the latent stage so that they can get rid of the pathogen before it becomes active. If it has already become active, more than one antibiotic may be needed to be taken at the same time. If the patient decides to stop treatment or they skip doses, this will cause the bacteria to continue living and can make it resistant to those drugs, which makes it harder to treat afterwards. If you have a drug-resistant TB, antibiotics or fluoroquinolones will need to be taken. A vaccine currently exists to prevent TB, known as a Bacille-Calmette-Guérin BCG vaccine. In other countries outside of the United States, the vaccine is given to infants and small children where TB is common. In the United States, the BCG vaccine should only be considered for some, not all people. Healthcare workers, for example, should be considered for the vaccine since they could possibly be working with those infected with TB. As with most infectious diseases, good hygiene should always be implemented to prevent the transmission of this disease to others. Washing your hands and covering your nose and mouth when you cough and sneeze can make a big difference.